This week on Shop Talk, we have arts and crafts with Sip and Go Studio and handmade dolls from Dolldalita. We also have Savoy Collections, the newest watch brand in town. Plus, we have two healthy food options, Juju Eats and the Vegetarian Kitchen. So stay tuned for the next hour. I'm Ria Tanwat-Cotrillo. First up, we have Christopher Cruz, president of the 1990 Crusade Incorporated, and that's the company behind Sip and Go Paint and Sip Studio. That's a business he started with his friends just 5 months ago. Hello, Christopher. Thanks for coming on the show.
Good evening. Nice to be here.
Okay, tell us exactly what a Sip and Paint Studio is.
We basically offer guided painting sessions that already includes everything you need to be able to complete an artwork, plus a round of complimentary drinks and the appetizer snack that matches the chosen beverage of our guests.
All right, so it sounds like a kind of fun party idea or gimmick idea for us, say a family or a barcada or something.
Yes.
You want to do something different aside from just go out for a round of drinks. This is something they could try, right?
That's right.
Where did you get the idea for it?
One of the partners actually attended a painting party in California. Summer of last year. He was the one who brought up the idea of setting up a paint and sip studio, which we believe would be the first of its kind here in the Philippines. So since we've been friends since grade school, we're actually beneficiaries of the Tulung Dunong scholarship program of the Ateneo. And then after we've started our respective careers, we've been wanting to go into business together. And then when this idea was brought to us, that's when we decided it's a good idea.
Great. And it's fairly new in that you guys just opened, I think, back in December.
Right? 2012.
You know, how has it been since then, and what has the response been like?
We've been having a growing number of guests at the studio, so we're averaging around 150 to 200 guests a month.
Wow, that's pretty good.
That's right.
So when you take in a class, like how many people are there per class or per session?
We can accommodate as many as 40 painting guests at the studio. So it really depends on the number of people who register for the different painting sessions that we have.
All right. And of course, I'm sure a lot of people out there are interested in the sipping part.
Yes.
Of Sip and Go. Can people actually just go there if they want to just do, you know, the sipping part and they want to just, you know, have a round of drinks? Do they have to paint?
No, they don't really have to paint because we have a bar that offers different drinks for those who simply want to go there for something to drink. So they can join their friends who might want to paint, and they just stay or hang out at the bar area.
All right. But I'm sure at some point those people who go just for the drinks end up painting as well.
Yes.
Right?
They get curious of what's actually happening. They see that our guests are having fun. So they eventually try it out. And at the end, they would have themselves set up for painting as well.
Okay, so I was looking at the pictures that we were flashing on the screen just a second ago, and everybody, it seems, paints more or less the same painting or the same picture, right? Tell me a little bit more about exactly how the guided painting sessions are conducted.
Yes, we have our website, and there's a calendar page where we have the featured painting specified for that particular session. So interested guests may register for the featured painting, or if we have a lean number of guests, they can actually request that they paint something else.
Okay.
So it really depends on the number of guests that we have at the time.
Okay,
if there's a huge number of guests, then we suggest that they paint the same thing because it'll be difficult to provide guided instruction for a lot of guests.
Okay, and like what's the instructor to student ratio in the sessions?
It's about one art instructor to eight guests.
All right.
They can actually handle as many as eight painters.
And I see that our painters here today are actually staying true to the name of your paint and sip studio, and they're doing a Van Gogh inspired piece, right?
Right.
Okay. And then of course, if you look at our in studio painters, they are of all ages. Our youngest painter is 9, and then of course the others are of working age. Normally, how do you break up the age ranges? Do you have classes for kids, for adults, for teens?
Yeah, we have particular sessions based on the age group. We have what we call Little Van Gogh, scheduled every Saturday at 10. For kids, ideally 7 years old and up. But we've had guests as young as 4. And then we have what we call our family fun day session at 4 p.m. from Tuesday to Sunday. And then adult session, a regular session at 8 p.m.
Okay, so given the range in age of your guests, what are the different types of drinks that you serve to accommodate
them? Yeah, for adults, we serve alcoholic beverages. We have wines, both red and white. We have cocktails, margarita, cosmopolitan, martini, imported beers as well.
Okay, it sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, well, they say wine appreciation and art appreciation are both subjective, so at the end of the session, with enough alcohol in your system, you'll end up appreciating your artwork.
And being quite creative. So how do you guys charge for the classes?
The prices range between 900 to 1,200. It really depends on the session that you will attend. For kids, at every Saturday at 10, it's 900 because they paint using a smaller canvas. And then we serve juices, iced tea, non-alcoholic drinks for kids, and kid snacks.
Okay. And the great thing is, though, that everything is included. Like, you just have to show up, and all the material you need will be there.
Right. Everything's provided. You just need to bring yourself and your enthusiasm to paint.
And your enthusiasm. That's
good. No painting skills required, actually, because we provide instruction.
Wonderful.
From sketching to color mixing to application of the right brush strokes.
And do people need to make reservations ahead of time, or you accept walk-ins?
We do accept walk-ins, but we highly recommend that they register ahead of time to guarantee the slots, because we don't want to turn away people who might decide to just walk in, and we might have a private party or it's a full house.
Right. Speaking of private parties, obviously you cater to those. What are some of the types of occasions you've hosted? Are they like birthdays, showers?
Yeah, we've hosted a number of birthday parties for kids, for those celebrating their 18th birthday. And we also had a celebrant who had his 75th birthday at the studio.
75th?
Yes.
Oh,
and then
nice.
We've hosted also team building activities for corporate clients.
Okay, and when people come out of Sip and Go Paint and Sip Studio, you know, what do they say about the experience that they had?
Because more than 90% of our guests are first-time painters, actually they say that they get to develop a sense of fulfillment, that they were able to conquer their fear about painting the first time. So that's the satisfaction that they're able to get out of the experience, and probably the reason why they also come back.
Sure. And it sounds like something fun, and certainly the people in the pictures all have very big smiles on their faces, looking very accomplished. What can we expect from you guys in the future? How are you planning to expand, if at all?
We're actually trying to standardize our operations now, because our short-term objective is to open another branch, preferably in the south of the metro, because we've had a lot of inquiries if we have other branches and people as far as Makati, Alabang, they wanted to know if you had a branch near their areas. And then in the long term, the plan is to actually offer the business for franchising.
Wow, amazing. Mm-hmm. That's great. Okay, and we have some paintings here. Is this done by an actual student, or is it one of the instructors?
Most of the paintings that we have at the studio are actually made by our artists, because at the end of the session, our guests bring home their own artworks.
Right, right. Yeah. So in the span of however many hours, that's enough time for them to accomplish the work and to have it dried and everything?
Yes, that's right. We actually allot 3 hours for the session. The guest can actually finish their artworks in 2 hours, and then the rest of the time for drying, and then for them to enjoy the drinks and the snacks that we serve.
Can you actually frame it for them if they want?
At the moment, we don't have that service yet, but we're planning to include that in the future.
Great. Something, lots to look forward to, actually, from you guys. Maybe before I let you go, Christopher, you want to invite everyone to Sip and Go?
Yeah. To all the televiewers of Shop Talk, I'd like to invite you over to Sip and Go. We're located at the ground floor of Capitol Green Street, Capitol Hills, Quezon City. And you can visit our website at www.sipandgo.com. That's SIPANDGOGH.com.
Great. Nice to know that there's another thing we can do in the metro, something a little different, more creative, aside from just going to the malls, right?
Yes, right. And something productive as well.
Wonderful. Christopher, right. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me.
Well, from painting, we'll go to doll making as we talk to a mompreneur who makes Waldorf dolls. That's coming up after this break, so stay tuned. Welcome back to Shop Talk. With us now is mompreneur Jacqueline Colmenares Zapatos, the doll maker behind Dolldalita. Hello, Jack. Welcome to the show.
Hi. Thank you for having me.
Okay, you hand make the dolls that you sell.
Yes.
But first, explain how Waldorf dolls are different from the typical commercial ones.
Okay, a Waldorf doll is actually a cloth doll where they're expressionless so that the child can mimic their emotion, either they're happy or they're sad, to the doll without it being imposing a happy face or a sad face to them. And the overall principle of the doll is a simple doll, a simple cloth doll made out of natural materials.
Right, okay, which is very, the expressionless face is really important for imaginative play,
yes.
Right?
Yes, correct.
Okay, and how did you get into making Waldorf dolls?
About 2 years ago, I got invited to the 10A Alabama Arts and Craft Fair, and I used to make quilts. Ever since I was young, I made quilts. And ever since then, the ladies of 10A Alabama invited me. So I had so much retazos of fabric, I didn't know what to do with them. So I started making oddly shaped dolls. Then from there, like, I think the moms around 10A Alabama are also Waldorf parents, so they were the ones who introduced it to me. So I researched about it online, and from there I just learned how to do it on my own.
Wow, so you didn't take like some of those Waldorf workshops, you studied a lot online?
Yes, I did.
Okay. How long does it take you to make one doll?
From scratch it takes me about 6 to 10 hours, but what I do is on a weekend I'll spend that on just making the swatches of the dolls or tracing the patterns, and then there'll be a weekend I'll be stuffing and another weekend where I'll assemble them. So, but if I put it all together, one doll is about 6 hours.
Okay, but you do it sort of like in an assembly line fashion.
Yes, because it's all on me. Because I'm the one who makes everything. I sometimes ask help from some people to help me out. Like the nanny of my son helps me at home. But that's about it. That's about the much help I get. Recently, I was able to have RJ Rafael, she's an interior industrial designer, to help me make the heads. So at least now I have another person helping me make the dolls.
At least in one step of the process.
Yes.
Right. Okay. I'm a Waldorf mom too, and I've tried making even the simplest doll, and I just have to say it's not easy at all. Especially if you know if you're not a crafty person, mm-hmm. to begin with, right? Mm-hmm. But you know, given that we're in this high tech media world. Mm-hmm. Where everything looks like a cartoon, at least a lot of the things that kids are exposed to, you know, mm-hmm. very cartoony, very, I don't know how to say it, maybe manufactured or commercialized. Do you find that there is a market for very simple artisanal dolls?
I'm actually quite surprised at the number of moms who really can relate to the dolls and at their action the kids have for the dolls. Normally, the mom wouldn't know what it is, but once a kid gets it, like recently I had to mend a doll for a kid, and I told her, I'll replace it for free. And she was like, no, you cannot replace her because she's Goldie and she's mine. Just have to fix her. So the attachment of the child to the simple dolls really amazes me and the moms as well. So from there, I've been surprised at the number of moms that come to me to ask for the dolls.
That's great. And so do you do like bespoke ones? For example, you know, I'll come to you and I'm like, Jack, I want one with purple hair and a
yes.
green dress and a this and that. You can do that.
Yeah, I do custom, like, but the best custom I do would just be like the hair, or they want it to look like their child. So if the child has an apple cut hair or the child has pigtails, I try to mimic that, but still keeping it simple and expressionless.
Right. And how where do people find the dolls? Are they online? Are you in the bazaar circuit?
No, I don't do bazaars because I've noticed that's not my market. So I only do the art fair and the Balik Bukid fair, so the 10A Alabama art fair, and then I only sell them online. So right now I have a website which is iamhandmade.com, but there's not a lot up there because it's right. just me making. So my Facebook page, which is i.m.handmade, that's where I normally sell them.
Okay, so that's where people can see like the bulk of your stuff.
Right now there's nothing online.
Not yet,
because I have a lot of orders. I'm trying to finish that before I can upload certain things online. I get surprised that when I upload, they get sold out like on the same day.
Yeah, I was gonna say, how do you cope with the demands of the business, given that you know one piece takes you like 8 hours plus?
So I've announced online that I can only make $12 to $14 a month. So they try that. I've been lucky that the moms wait. They're patient enough to wait for me to come around to making their dolls.
Okay, so they understand really like the craft and the work.
Yes.
That's being put into it.
Yeah.
Now for you, as the mompreneur, what are the rewards of being in this type of business?
Well, I like that I can share, because I really like the overall concept of a simple toy, because I give that for my son. So I like that I can share that to the parents and to the children as well. And when the kids really fall in love with the doll, that gets me every single time.
Right. And, you know, since it appears that demand is going to increase, especially after being on Shop Talk, right? People are going to be going to the website inquiring about this. How are you planning to keep up with the growing demand?
I still want to keep the production very low because I want to still keep it keen on being handmade and not being mass produced. So I've taken RJ to help me out on making the head, and I plan to take on another lady who will help me make the dresses and the clothes. But that's about it right now for me.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. And given that so much effort and love is put into these dolls, how much do they go for?
Locally, they're 1,000 pesos each. And I also sell online. But of course, for the U.S. market, there's a different price.
For sure. And do you do other types of stuffed toys aside from the dolls? Do you do animals or whatever?
Upon request, I sometimes do. But I really just focus on Dolldalita. Sometimes I make the rag doll, which is this one. So it's a more simple doll that I also come out with. I do this sometimes when I'm stressed with this.
There's always an alternative.
Yeah, right? There's always an alternative to the dolls.
Right. And I'm looking at the hair of the little redhead over there. You know, that's not a material that I see readily available in stores. How do you source out the materials?
My materials, like some of the clothes for the dolls, I buy them on my travels. So like recently I came from Tokyo, I bought yukata fabric. So the dolls had yukata fabrics. And like for this one, there's a lady who sells online, Yarn Source Manila, and she sells imported yarns. I also don't know how she sells, where she finds it, but I'm grateful for her. So like this is mohair, so she's the only one who has it, so I buy that from her. And for the other dolls, I ensure that I use organic dye, like for this ones, so that even if the child ingests it, it's still okay for them.
Wonderful. And I love that they don't have button eyes. Those are like thread, right?
Yes.
So the kid can't pull them off and God forbid swallow them or whatever. How do you maintain a doll like that? Obviously it's made out of cloth, so she's bound to get dirty, right?
Yeah, it's just wash. You can wash it. You can lightly wash it with any detergent you have at home. She has cotton. This is actually open fiber that you have inside. A Waldorf doll, the strict Waldorf doll will have wool, but we don't have wool locally, so I use local material. So this is open fiber. It's the same fiber material that they use for comforters, so you can actually wash it if and then I also do mending. So like if I'm in a fair and there are kids who bring their dolls to me, I mend them for them. Yeah.
Wonderful. And what's the age range of the kids who play with your dolls, and are they all girls?
Oh, there's boys. Recently there were boys who bought dolls for me, and they asked it to look like a ninja. And this is actually a little mister. So there's okay, that's my boy.
Cute.
That's my boy series of dogs.
So this is for little guys.
Yes, for little guys. Right. They're supposed to have the personality of my son. That's why they're a little naughty.
Oh, a little naughty. And then he's got a mask going on.
Yeah,
right?
The mask is from Monstrella Plush Art. I kind of collaborated with them.
Oh, it's upside down, though, right?
Yeah, it's upside down.
Okay, he's supposed to be a fox. There you go.
Yeah. So I collaborate with fellow crafters from Alabama.
That's
so cute. So that I don't have to do everything from scratch.
good, because yeah, a lot of mompreneurs tend to want to do things completely by themselves.
Yes.
Right? Okay, great. And lastly, what advice do you have for other crafters and people doing artisanal work like you?
Just keep it small. Don't think of invading the entire retail market. And if you're true to the principle of what your craft is about, people will open up their hearts to it as well. It has to be something that they can really feel your heart into it. It's not like you're just doing it because you want the money. Of course, everyone wants the money, but you have to wait for people to acknowledge you slowly, I guess. It's not as fast as others, but the rewards are better.
Right, and you love it, you too.
Yes.
Right. All right, Jack, thank you so much for shop talking with us.
Thank you very much for having me as well.
Well, we're taking another break right now, but we'll be right back. Keep it here on ANC. Savoy Collections is the newest watch brand in town. The brand's first boutique in Asia opened shop at the New World Hotel in Makati, and I had the chance to talk to the exclusive distributor of Savoy in the country, Chito Bautista of Time Bound Trading. I also spoke to the man behind the watch, Pascal Savoy himself, and I started the interview by asking Pascal about the inspiration for Savoy Collections.
Well, we started the brand very recently, so it's about a year and a half old. So we started shipping the first time at the end of 2011. So last year was really our first year in business. So we're very proud to be here already today.
Now, the brand, the Savoy, it has your name. You designed the watches. Tell us a little bit about your background. How did you come to do this?
Well, you know, I was born in Geneva, Switzerland, so watchmaking is natural for me. And I've been doing this since I was 25, so I have almost 18 years of experience in the business. So I started pretty young, and I love watches, and the business of watches, they're one of the few accessories a man can have. So about a couple of years ago, I've been working for big groups, and more recently for Hublot Watches. I was president of Hublot Watches, one of the main watch companies in the world, based in Miami. And then a few years ago, I decided to leave and do my own brand. It's a challenge for me. I always admired people that start their own business. I'm very entrepreneurial myself. And I really thought there was a lack and a gap in the business for these kind of watches. So I wanted to benefit. Just not myself, as myself and partners and a large Swiss group that is behind me enabled to partner on this. A lot of people are behind the brand beside myself. Yeah.
Now, the pieces look very bold and very modern. Aside from that, how else would you describe the look and the aesthetic of Savoy watches?
Well, the Savoy customer is a modern, independent woman and men, for example. So we wanted a piece that is very iconic, which is the name of the collection, the Icon Collection. So when we design it, basically, when you see a Savoy piece, you recognize this kind of watch among the other ones. I just didn't want to bring another duplicate what's been in before. So we wanted to be fresh and new, people that are bold and make the decision themselves, and they don't need to follow the trend necessarily. So the watch is for them. When you see the business today and you walk in the shops or the mall and you see a lot of watches in the window, they are confusing to me. You see a lot of brands there, and it's very difficult to identify which design belongs to which brand. So I wanted to do a watch when you see us in the window, you know it's a Savoy for sure. So it needs to be a particular design.
Now, the watches all have one basic design, but in spite of that, how are you able to change the look and the colors?
Well, I travel a lot, and I like different fusion of materials and leathers, for example. And we think that it was better to use an insert concept. So we have a trademark, it's actually trademarked worldwide, an insert concept where you can change on the straps the material that you want, the look of the watch. Or we don't feel you need to come with different designs of a case to be versatile.
Now, Pascal, who would you like to see wearing your watches?
Well, we like celebrities, of course, because you know, they put us on the map. It's very important. We don't necessarily need celebrities also. We like business people, people that have an influential position in the world that carry our watches. Like I said at the beginning, we like strong, independent people that are leaders in their field. So it doesn't have to be necessarily a celebrity, but people that have a mind on their own.
Given that Savoy is a very new brand, tell us a little bit about your presence in other countries or in the region.
Well, we started strategically last year in 2012 with the Middle East and the Americas. So we have a very strong presence in the States, Caribbean, and Latin America, especially Mexico, for example. So we know that the brand performed well in Latin countries. So that was our goal in 2012. Now in 2013, we start to attack Europe and Asia. So what, at this moment, as of today, we have about 15 countries around the world, which is a nice feat already in 1 year business. And Philippines is the first boutique in the world.
As we said, Savoy is a very young brand. I'm sure you have lots of plans for it in the future. Tell us about your big picture planning for the brand.
Savoy is more than a watch company, it's really a lifestyle brand. So we start introducing the concept to people with watches because that's myself and the group do best. We're always working with accessories. We have pens, we have cufflinks, we're working on leather goods, and down the road we want to duplicate the concept to sunglasses, perfume. I mean, there's no limit. So the boutique as we have today is a nice step because that will allow us to bring other accessories. So this is where we want to be with the brand, and not perceived as a watch company, but as a lifestyle, with all the concept of the affordable luxury.
Chito, how did you discover the Savoy brand, and what made you decide to bring it to the Philippines?
We were on a cruise in southern Spain, and I saw this watch, and it was so remarkable. The design is cut above the rest. I haven't seen any designs such as this. So my wife bought me one right on the spot. And that's the time I met Pascal Savoy. He presented me with the watch himself. So I applied for the distributorship, the exclusive distributorship for the Philippines. And a year after, we established this store here at New World in Makati.
Did you have any apprehensions at all about bringing it to the country, considering Pinoys usually gravitate towards the more known, more old school brands?
I understand that, but it's the best time to start a business in the Philippines. Moody's is just around the corner, and the income of our population is increasing, and they will increase their possessions. So I think we're not too worried about the branded, the known watches, because our watches has value for money. It's the value proposition that we appeal to whatever buyers are going to buy.
Aside from the things you mentioned, what do you think will help you capture the Philippine market?
Well, the design and the look and the exclusivity. It's a what I call a pace-setting trend that we want to establish. And later on, will evolve into the lifestyle Savoy collections in the Philippines.
And how are you planning to expand Savoy within the Philippines?
Yeah, we plan to open a couple of stores, and our strategy is not only in the Philippines, but on the regional side of Asia as well.
And Chito, of course, you yourself have a Savoy watch on your wrist. Tell us a little bit about what it is and why you chose it.
This is the particular model that I chose because it is very versatile. I can use it in the office Monday to Friday, and when I go to the mall on the weekend, I can use it, or even attend a wedding in the evening. So the watches are very noticeable. One day, I joined a dinner party, and from afar, they noticed my watch, and they said, wow, that must be expensive. And I said, this has value for money.
Well, up next, we'll feature a new salad joint called Juju Eats. Keep it here. Shop Talk. We'll be right back. We had Juju Cleanse on the show before, but now it's time to talk about the salad joint that they set up to encourage people to eat their greens. So with us to talk about Juju Eats are David and Kat Azanza. Hi, folks. Welcome
Hi.
Back
Hi.
To Shop
Hi.
Talk.
Thank you.
Okay, congratulations on the opening of your restaurant, Juju Eats. It's how old now?
2 months.
2 months
yeah.
old. So what was the process from having the, you know, the juice service, let's mm-hmm. say? How is it going from that to a full-on restaurant?
Well, our company is basically concerned about providing health and wellness to as many people as we can. And obviously, Juju Cleanse, as good as it is, targets a very specific market. And we wanted to bring a healthy product to a wider demographic, basically a wider base. And salad just seemed a natural fit with what we were already doing.
Right, and so was born Juju Eats. So it's not like you have to be in a cleanse or anything,
not at all,
right?
Not at all.
This is just like regular lunch, merienda food,
that's right.
healthy food that people want. Yeah. So how did you come up with the menu, Kat?
With the menu, well, we worked together with a chef consultant. We told him exactly what we wanted, our concept, and basically we were the ones that not dictated, but
we had in mind what we wanted to see on the menu, but really, the Juju Eats concept is about people coming in and eventually becoming so comfortable with salad that they make their own.
Right.
It's a DIY concept at heart.
Right.
So really, you can customize it to your heart's content. We have a la carte salads there to encourage people to come in. They taste great to begin with, but for people that are unsure about salads to begin with, at least they have a starting point.
So we have a salad that's it's a Mexican-inspired salad. We have a Filipino-inspired salad. We have your classic chicken Caesar. We have your classic Greek salad. We have a whole range of salad, and we try to put our own kind of unique spin on each and every one of them.
Right. So you have that, the sort of quote-unquote ready-made stuff,
mm-hmm.
and then they also have the option of putting together their own.
Yes.
That's right.
Right. Okay. How would people need to know? I think that you're not a purely vegetarian
That's
restaurant, right?
We have meats and chicken and pork. We're like I said, we're trying to, because when people here think of salad, they think of iceberg, Thousand Island, and cucumber slices, right? So we're trying to make salad appealing to as wide a range of people as possible, and by doing that, you know, we have to have meat because not everyone just wants greens and carrots.
Right.
At the same time, a lot of people are afraid of greens, so we actually have pasta as one of our bases. You can have a nice pasta salad.
Okay,
as well.
So carbs are allowed.
Carbs are allowed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Good to know. And you also, of course, serve your famous juices there.
That's
yes,
right.
yes, we do.
Right.
And we've developed 3 new juices just for the store as well.
Right. Great. Okay, so you guys are like in the middle of Makati.
Yes.
There's like a lot of office type establishments where you are. Is that the crowd that you get? Purely the office workers, or it's a mix?
Well, we're very lucky because we're on a street that has a lot of office buildings. At the same time, we're at the fringe of Las Marinas Village, so we get a good mix of office workers as well as families. You know, moms that come in the morning after their workouts, in the afternoon they bring their kids in. They come in after school. And
yeah, but the core clientele obviously
yes.
is the working group.
Okay, you mentioned moms and kids. Are you successful in getting kids to eat their veggies?
I have to say, honestly, yes. I am so proud. Like, we have a customer who told us the other day that her son was so in love with our wraps, because we have salad wraps where you put the salad in a wrap, and he wanted to spend his birthday dinner at Juju because he wanted to have his salad wrap. And he's not a veggie boy, apparently. So we have a lot of kids coming from school after school. They come in for their wraps or their salads or their green juice. So
that's
a lot
wonderful.
Of children are liking the green juice. So I'm so happy to hear that.
That's great.
Yeah.
Okay, and then do you guys have a service? I mean, do you guys deliver, or do you have people who, you know, who may be on a diet, and then, you know, do you like pre-deliver like a whole day's worth of salad or a whole week's worth of salad? Do you do that?
Well, on the delivery side, we are tied up with a delivery service. So 87878, we can deliver anywhere basically in the metropolis. as far as the tie-up with Juju Cleanse, we're still working towards that. Yeah, because they function independently of each other.
Right, right. And I have to do a taste test. Really,
absolutely.
Really, just, you know, such a difficult thing to do.
So this is our delivery container.
Okay.
So if you were doing a takeout, this is the container that it would come in.
All right.
And so right now you have here the chicken Caesar.
The chicken Caesar.
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry.
You don't. That's all right.
Yeah.
So for this, of course, this has meat in it, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then what's in the dressing?
It's a mayonnaise-based dressing, like a traditional Caesar. So there's anchovies.
Right. Okay. So it's not like, you know, we're gonna torture ourselves with something that's completely fat-free
or whatever. No.
Right. So how we do this, sorry, we have a little bit of a technique, right, David?
Okay.
So we, hold on, I'll help you out with this one.
Oh, okay, great. You're going to mix it for me?
Well, yeah. Hold on.
Just to get it started.
Technique. All right. So, but if you're...
We just found that this works.
Okay.
Yeah, so we close it up again.
Shake, shake, shake?
It's the shake, shake, shake. Yeah.
Ah.
The shake, shake, shake really works.
Awesome. Great. Yeah, instead of like mixing it and tossing it like half the day.
Yeah.
That's not a bad option at all.
No, it's a little bit messy, but it gets the job done.
There's a lot more theater in the store itself.
So. Okay. And so if I'm eating in the restaurant, it doesn't come in this package, and it just comes like in a bowl or a plate.
Yes, it comes in a bowl.
Everybody's jealous because they want to try my salad. It's great. It's great. And then is the stuff you serve organic or not necessarily?
We work with some of our vegetables are organic, mm-hmm. but the problem that we have found is that we can't get enough supply as we actually need.
Right, right.
So what ends up happening is it's a bit of a mix. We do have some that we can get purely organic and some sometimes we don't. Yeah.
Right, okay. And then what's the price range for the salads and the wraps and the pastas?
Our salads and wraps start at $135 for the regular DIY salad, half DIY salad or a wrap, and then they go up from there. Each of the a la cartes is priced differently, and obviously if you DIY a salad, it depends what you decide to put in there.
Yeah,
right.
But the range is between $135 and I would say close to $300.
Okay, and they're all pretty much the size.
Yes. Oh, well, we have
two
sizes. We have a regular and a half. Mm-hmm. So this is the regular box and this is the half box.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And we also serve soup, so some people can just have a wrap and a soup or a half a salad and a soup.
Yeah, and we have coffees, we have fresh fruit sodas, slushes, all that stuff as well.
Nice. And does that mean you're open only during lunch because you're like, you know, in the office area, or you've got the whole dinner thing going too?
We started out 10 to 7, but starting next week we'll be open 10 to 8, Monday to Friday, and then 10 to 3, Saturday, Sunday.
Great. And what kind of feedback have you gotten, aside from the moms who say that their kids now eat vegetables and want to have their party there?
Right, yeah. Well, that was my happiest moment. But
our concern in putting this restaurant up was that the food came first. So we wanted the food to taste great, and so far the response has been fantastic in that regard. People are really liking the flavors and the mixes and everything. We have a regular crew of people coming back because... In the end, we want it to be good food. It happens to be salad, but it's great food.
Right, exactly. Can I try one more with
that one? This is a pasta salad. This is a tuna niçoise.
Oh, okay, I love niçoise.
Yes.
All right. And so that's pasta. We got the carbs in there.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Right. Okay. And obviously, this is the type of food that needs to be eaten like really fresh.
Yes.
So like, how long could you keep it and still maintain the quality?
I mean, if you're taking it home or taking it out, if you have a chiller in the office and you want to keep it, then I'd advise keeping it in there. Don't keep it for days, obviously, because then it is still...
Yeah, and your greens are going to get soggy.
That's
and that's not going to be much fun. Okay, so this is your...
Tuna niçoise pasta.
What are your personal favorites?
That's my favorite. That together with a salad that we have called Inasal salad. It's a Pinoy... It's got a very Pinoy spin on it, and I love it.
Is there such a thing?
Yeah.
Okay, there is now.
what is it? What's in the inasal salad?
It's a pork inasal and green mango and red onions and just a whole bunch of...
It's got feta.
Yeah, it's a very, very Pinoy flavor.
Yeah.
It's really interesting, actually.
It's pork inasal salad with balayan dressing.
Yeah. Wow. It's a bagoongi thing.
Yeah, it's yummy.
Happening.
It's really good.
That's amazing. That's great. Okay, guys, please invite everyone to Juju Eats.
Where do I look? Okay.
Anywhere.
Thank you for having us on the show. We'd like to invite anyone looking for a good salad and good eats to come down to Juju Eats. We're on the ground floor of the BCS building, 2297 Paso Antonio Extension in Makati.
Great. Kat, David Asanza, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Talking with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we have more healthy stuff for you as we check the menu of the Vegetarian Kitchen. The final stretch of Shop Talk is coming up, so stay with us. Welcome back to Shop Talk. If you're craving home-cooked and healthy dishes, you may want to check out what the Vegetarian Kitchen has to offer. Here to tell us more about the restaurant are siblings Kiko Solyonko and Camille Solyonko Acosta. Hi guys, welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you for having us. Good evening.
Okay, tell us a bit about how this all started. How did you guys come to be vegetarian?
So the Vegetarian Kitchen started back in the 90s. It started in our ancestral house in Quezon City. And my mom was the one who put up everything, actually.
Yeah, so my mom actually came from a carnivorous background. But when she met my dad, who was a Hare Krishna devotee back in 1988, then she had to change the way our family ate. So she challenged herself, and she went through a period of experimentation and invention. And the dishes that were the result of that experimentation and invention period were the dishes that were served in the first Vegetarian Kitchen. Yes.
Right.
But unfortunately, back in the day, vegetarianism is not so popular, so the restaurant didn't survive, so we had to close down.
Yeah.
Okay,
yes.
This was back in the 90s.
Yeah,
yes,
you
fast
90s.
Forward to
yes.
the 2000s. Of course, everybody's really looking to be as healthy as possible.
Yes.
Actually, yes.
Right. And so when did you guys reopen the Vegetarian?
So we reopened 18th of April last year, and we're happy to say that from the time we opened, the kitchen has grown, and it has become a haven for all kinds of vegetarians and meat eaters who are looking probably for a healthier but tasteful alternative to their usual diet.
Right, okay. But just to note, I mean, you guys were not, even though your mom was vegetarian, she didn't force you guys to be vegetarian as kids, right?
No.
We were eating meat until I was 18.
Yeah, we grew up with our grandmother, so we were eating meat. But then when she passed away, we moved in with my mom, and we got used to eating vegetarian food.
Right.
Yes, because we thought we would be missing out on the good stuff. But
sure.
When we started living with my mom, mm-hmm. we would have tocino and sausage for breakfast, and we even have danggit. So
mm-hmm. And we have eggs, but then not the real thing. It's made
right,
with
like
tofu.
Yes.
Like that.
Okay. And like you said, that there's people who go to the restaurant who aren't vegetarians,
yes.
right?
Mm-hmm.
They just want to go for a vegetarian
yes.
meal.
Yes.
What are your best sellers?
So our best sellers are, this is the tocino with scrambled tofu.
Okay. All right, so you have that. And this is like an all-day thing, is it?
Yes, so it's an all-day breakfast thing. And then what we have here is an Indian dish.
Mm-hmm.
It's cabbage and cauliflower kofta.
Okay.
It's served with brown rice. This is a Krabby Patty. Yeah, so it's served with tofu mayo, and then this one is malunggay lasagna.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's something different that we have. So it has red and white sauce also, so to neutralize the flavor. And then this one is our take on paella. So that's a fusion dish. That's couscous paella with curried shrimp tempura and wasabi mayo.
Okay.
And this is our dessert. That's orange cheesecake.
Ah,
so
okay.
These are some of our best sellers.
Mm-hmm.
Our menu has been customized to suit the taste of both vegetarians and meat eaters. So there are transition dishes because a lot of people want to go vegetarian, but some of them are scared
right.
because they get served vegetables that aren't cooked, like just boiled or steamed. So we try to approximate the taste and the texture of the
mm-hmm.
real thing.
Right, it's anything but boring. And you know,
yes.
looking at the dishes, they're so alive, they're so
yes.
colorful.
Mm-hmm.
So you mentioned that there's no egg. Do you use dairy still?
Yeah, since we're vegetarians, we still take dairy. But we have a lot of vegan dishes that
don't contain any dairy
yes.
or any animal product whatsoever.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm told I should try the tocino.
Yes,
right?
That's
which is,
the
which
vegetarian
is
tocino. We use a wheat-based meat substitute for that, and the tofu scramble That's our take on the scrambled egg.
Okay, yes. I'm gonna have it with a bit of rice, with a bit of quote-unquote
egg. That's the vegetarian version of tosilog.
Tosilog,
okay.
Yes.
Okay, all right. So you don't have to give it up completely.
Oh, you don't have to at all, yes.
Right? Okay. Wow.
Isn't it
really
like a real
thing? Real thing.
Yes.
I'm not kidding.
Without, mm-hmm. without, it's very lean, so mm-hmm. without the cholesterol, without the bad things.
So on every dish, we really specialize on the texture and the taste.
Right. Yes. It's sort of, it's very tender. It has like the sweet saltiness of the
The real thing, yes.
Wow, I wouldn't feel cheated at all out of the whole tosilog experience if I ate this.
Yes, a lot of our guests actually tell us that they can become vegetarian if this is the kind of food they get served every day.
Mm-hmm. I bet.
That's basically how we felt living with our mom. So we weren't missing out on anything.
Okay, yes. Well, I don't want to miss out on any more. Give me some of that. What
this
is
one?
That?
Okay.
I recommend this one, the lasagna.
The lasagna. Okay, don't worry. I'm gonna get to the lasagna as well. Okay, so what am I eating here?
So this is cabbage and cauliflower kofta. Okay. It's an Indian dish. All right. So here you go.
That's okay. an all-vegetable dish.
So what's in the bowls?
Cabbage and cauliflower with a lot of Indian spices. Mm.
So it's on the spicy side.
Okay, that's fine. We like spicy around here. I'm gonna do my happy dance with all the good food. That's great.
Yes, and we serve it with brown rice. Because a lot of people are also looking for pure vegetable dishes. So that's what we can offer them.
Wonderful. And what's the price range for the dishes?
So it's around 190 to 270. So it's very cheap considering the size of our serving. Because we don't, since we grow up in a vegetarian household, environment, household, so we like it, since it's vegetables, our servings are large.
Yes, we feel like we're shortchanging the customers because vegetables don't cost as much as meat.
Right.
So we give them hefty serving. It's good for sharing.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's great. So then everyone, you can serve it family style.
Yes.
Yeah, and I assume you have a lot of families coming into the restaurant.
Yes, they do come, yes.
Great, okay, so last but not least is dessert, right? Tell me what this is made of or how.